Buonasera, signori e signori. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's a very great pleasure to see everybody here for this lecture this evening. We're off schedule on a Monday because at the end of this week, our artist Mostra will open, so I hope you'll all return for that. But being off schedule simply allows us to enjoy the pleasures of this week's lecture 2 days early. Excellent. It's a great pleasure to introduce Annalisa Marzano from the University of Reading, who is also our last fellow at the British School at Rome. Annalisa has studied at Florence and Columbia. Before her appointment at Reading University, she taught at Columbia University and the University of Oxford, where she was research assistant at the Institute of Archaeology and a member of the Oxford Roman Economy Project, as well as W. Golding Research Fellow at Brasenose College. She has written extensively on a wide range of topics, but with a strong focus on the Roman economy, on Roman villas, on imperial propaganda, and on marine resources, large-scale fishing and aquaculture. She has a completely enviable range of field experience: Naples, Egypt, Rome, Benghazi, Bay of Naples, Siena, Florence, lots of lovely, lovely places. And all of this work has eventuated in a large number of publications, all of them of the highest quality. Four volumes, a tantalizing volume on Roman marine fish ponds, Villas in the Mediterranean Basin, which is going to be a very substantial contribution, Harvesting the Sea, the Exploitation of Marine Resources in the Roman Mediterranean, and her groundbreaking book, Roman Villas in Central Italy, A Social and Economic History, which came out in 2007. She's written many articles, and Annalisa knows, because I keep on citing it, that amongst them is this wonderful article called Snails, Wine, and Winter Navigation, which was not having perhaps received quite the attention it should have done, actually turns out to be one of many completely groundbreaking contributions. And she will no doubt tell you all about snails and wine at a subsequent point in time. We perhaps should have put it on the menu for this evening. Annalisa's work really is at the forefront of the way that we can now bring together archaeological research of the highest quality, but also texts and a variety of texts, and put them within new methodological and theoretical frameworks. And it's very, very exciting to have had Annalisa with us over the past 3 months with Dennis, and we've really, really been so grateful to you for the way that you've interacted with all of us and given us so much to this community. It's been really wonderful having you with us. This joy will continue, I'm sure, with this evening's lecture, bringing all those various multidisciplinary strands together: horticulture, elite self-representation, and botanical imperialism in ancient Rome. Annalisa.
Thank you, Christopher. Thank you for the very generous introduction, and hopefully I will not disappoint you tonight. In book 15 of his Natural History, Pliny the Elder starts talking about gaining glory, being able to have an everlasting memorial. Now, these are all key words for any elite Romans, especially those who are engaged in political life, in military career. But in that passage, Pliny is not talking about military deeds. He's not talking about politicians doing grand things. He's talking about grafting new fruit varieties, naming the new fruit, and in this manner, being able to have an everlasting memorial, because nothing is so little that cannot produce glory. And this combination between plants, garden, and the idea of a memorial for posterity, it's something that is well established earlier than this period of Pliny. If we look, for instance, at the first century BC epitaph of the freedman Hostius Pamphilus, who was a medicus, a doctor, he writes that the tomb that he refers to, he says, well, this is our eternal home, this is our farm estate, not the fundus, This is our garden, this is our memorial. Now, of course, many Roman tombs had garden attached to them, but we have this combination, this commission between the idea of plants and a garden that can somehow become a monument to the person. So what I want to do tonight with you is to explore a little bit two different aspects involving plants and gardens in the Roman world. On the one end, the ideological, really symbolic aspect of the meaning of gardens, and particularly the meaning of gardens in the context of military expansion of Rome, and what I've called in my title botanical imperialism, so transplanting, bringing new plants into Italy or different provinces. And then move on to some considerations about more the practicalities, really, of growing things in one's garden, in one's villa estate, the economic value that might be in perhaps, you know, improving a particular fruit variety, making it better. And of course, if we remember that social standing in ancient Rome was determined on land owning, that was the element that determined the belonging to a specific class, a senator, an equestrian, and of course agriculture was at the center of a pre-industrial society like Rome, then consideration of what to grow, what to cultivate on one's estate had some relevance and were important. So we need to start first considering a little bit the gardens in the context of domestic architecture before venturing out also in what is the public architecture. As a way of setting the scene, what we are really concerned with when discussing the symbolism attached to the garden space in the house is the peristyle garden. So it's a green space surrounded by porticos and columns, porticos that one could stroll, that had not only, of course, plants, the peristyle garden also housed statues and were, you know, wall paintings in the porticos. So we start having the evolution in the Roman house and then in the Roman villas of a particular architectural element that comes to a certain point to symbolize a certain type of lifestyle. Whereas in earlier Roman houses, really the garden was what we may call a kitchen garden. You grow some vegetables, you have some herbs. With the peristyle, we're moving into a different realm. We're moving into a garden representing what culture and knowledge, so we're talking about something like this on a smaller scale of a house from Pompeii, but could be much grander in the big villas. A gardens that was a way of displaying the refined taste of the owner, of displaying his culture, the ability of collect work of arts, display work of arts. And it's also something that started becoming, especially in the late Republic, an element of that competitive display that is so characterizing of the Roman elite of the period. We see this in so many different spheres, from, you know, in the public sphere, but also in the private realm, in their houses, what they're doing, trying to outdo, you know, their peers. And also trickles down the social classes. It's something that is picked up and reflect in, let's say, the houses in Pompeii. There is quite a lot of, in the Roman literature, on authors like Cicero, but it's not the only one, a lot of reflection, consideration about the garden in the house, the peristyle garden, as the place for that intellectually productive leisure, the otium, where to engage in philosophical conversation, or where to set a literary works that is in a form of dialogue and so forth. And the fact that the garden could come to really symbolize the owner persona, but even the plants that were in the garden, is perhaps best signified, encapsulated in an anecdote, in a story about the fate of Cicero's trees from his villa in Tusculum. Now, when Cicero was exiled after the discovery of the conspiracy of Catiline in 63 BC, and then when Cicero was consul, and after that, having condemned to death Roman citizen, a law was passed and sent Cicero into exile, his property was seized, confiscated, and his political enemies went on to try to obliterate somehow the public persona of Cicero. So his house in Rome was razed to the ground in order to then erect a sacellum, a shrine to freedom, to libertas. the villa in Tusculum, we are told by Cicero himself in his speech, the Domus Sua, that all the furnishings, the tools from the villa were taken by his neighbor, the consul 58 BC, Gabinius, who also took the trees from his garden. The trees were taken, uprooted, and brought into Gabinius' nearby villa. Now, this story, I mean, of course, here we have a nice rhetorical crescendo. You know, this is a speech Caesar has written, and he's want to make an impression on his audience, so showing how much he was wronged, what he had to endure. They didn't stop at taking his statues and paintings and nice furniture. Even the trees were taken. But there is also something else in this story, in this passage. There is the idea that actually the trees that Cicero might have planted or that he might have cherished in the garden are somehow an extension of his public persona. And that by taking possession of them, appropriating them, they are somehow, you know, destroying what Cicero had represented, what he was in the public sphere of Rome. Of course, there could be some more practical consideration because, after all, mature trees have a value. It takes time. Now, we don't know what kind of trees in the specific example we are talking about. But whether we are talking about ornamental trees or fruit-bearing trees, if one plants a young plant, they have to wait a few years until either they grow and become big enough for the purpose, I don't know, to give a shade or to bear fruit. And there could be a value attached. It could have been a consideration of, you know, getting hold of some nice mature trees rather than having to plant some young plants and wait for a few years. The value of trees in the context of houses and real estate is also quite nicely encapsulated in another anecdote that we have from our literary sources. This time it concerns two censors, the two censors for 91 BC, Licinius Crassus and Domitius Enobarbus. This story is all about the house that Licinius Crassus had on the Palatine. This was quite a nice, lavish house, particularly there were some columns of precious Hemetian marble, and Domitius Enobarbus was really critical of Crassus having spent a considerable amount of money for the purchase of this column. So the anecdote goes like this. So we are told that Crassus asked Domitius, saying, well, okay, so what value do you put to my house then? And he said, well, I think your house is, you know, about 6 million sesterces. That should make it. And then Crassus, who had a peristyle garden with 10 lotus trees, this is Celtis australis, and is an ornamental plant, was valued because it gave a very nice shade in summer. In autumn and winter, would shed the leaves, so it wouldn't obstruct the sunlight from rooms that might be looking onto the peristyle. So he said, well, what value do you give to my house without the 10 trees I have in my garden? And Domitius said, well, 3 million sesterces. And then Crassus was like, well, then who is more extravagant? Is it me? I spend 100,000 sesterces to buy the columns of Hemetian marbles, or you are valuing just the shade of trees at 3 million sesterces? So this is, you know, it's a nice, witty anecdote, but it shows something about the mentality that is constructing symbolic values around the plants and how owners of these plants, owners of the garden, start to interact with each other. So, military conquest. In terms of plants, plant transplanting, using plants symbolic in the context of imperialism, we need to start with Pompey the Great and his triumph of 61 BC. Now, Pompey the Great, politician of Rome, victorious general, when he came back to Rome after all his campaign in the East and defeating the pirates and the Mithridates and so forth, celebrated really a lavish triumph. A triumph where the list of the population subdued, the city conquered, went on and on. I mean, there were, you know, triumph on Asia, on Pontus, on Nicaea, Pamphylia, Crete, and so forth. It was a very long list. And we know that was quite a lavish triumphal procession where the prisoners of war, the booty was displayed, as in any, you know, triumph, where the paintings showing the city conquered or key scenes of the campaigns were displayed. But also, we are told by Pliny the Elder, he displayed in this procession, among all this booty, some live trees. particularly the balsam tree that came from Judea, was typical of Judea, and the ebony tree from Ethiopia. In the context of this triumph, where there was so much in terms of wealth and booty, and indeed then afterwards many works of art would find their place, you know, in Rome and related to the Pompey's conquest, the trees, what do the trees really add? Was there really any need to add to this some trees? Well, these are clearly trees that were associated to specific geographical region that had seen the action and military campaigns on Pompey. They're also trees that had an economic value because they were, the balsam tree was used, the resin from balsam was used in the manufacture of perfumes and unguents, was also used in medicine. The ebony tree, a wood highly prized for furniture, for instance. And here it is where Pliny tells us that since, you know, the time of Pompey, even trees have been displayed in a triumph as if they were captives. So there is very often in Pliny there is this idea that somehow plants are have anthropomorphic characteristics attributed to them. So two trees that are from an economic point of view valuable, and indeed the balsam tree was so much associated with Judea that this was not the only time it was somehow paraded in Rome. Even Vespasian and Titus later on, and it's the same Pliny that tells us this in that same passage, they displayed at the end of the Jewish revolt after captured Jerusalem, when then celebrating their triumph in Rome, they displayed the balsam tree as a symbol of that particular region. Now, we are not told exactly, did they display it in the triumph like Pompey did? Did they just plant it in the Templum Pacis, the complex that was built then in Rome? I mean, some scholars have suggested that the garden of the Templum Pacis represented a sort of gazetteer, botanical gazetteer of the empire, with plants from different regions indicating the extent of Rome, Rome territories. We don't know, but we do know that it was a plant that was a considerable source of revenue for the region of Judea. Mark Antony had given the plantation of balsam tree to Cleopatra as a gift, and during the first Jewish revolt, the Jews had tried to destroy these plants because they were a source of revenue for Rome at that point. Via leases, the plants and the balsam were exploited, but the Romans managed to save the plants. Again, we have our Pliny with a little bit of his irony creeping in, because here we have these pitch battles that are fought to defend basically shrubs. But these are shrubs that bring to the fiscus, to the imperial chest, considerable revenue. And the idea of using plants as a symbol of territories, of conquest, it's something that is not limited to Rome. And there could be many examples brought here from different civilizations, different epochs, from the Persian kingdoms to the Assyrians, transplanting plant from region where they conquered. I'm just giving you one example from Egypt, the temple of Hatshepsut, where we have a relief showing trees being transported and then planted, and this has been put in relation to an expedition to the land of Punt, land famous for spices and other goods that were brought into Egypt that the queen had spearheaded. So these trees as a symbol of now something, a new connection, a new control Egypt has, and highly commercial values of this flow of goods. So Pompey displays trees in his triumph as a symbol of some of the regions that he had conquered, where he was successful militarily. But he's not the first general to bring plants back. He's the first we know of to have displayed in a triumph. But we know, of course, it's a very famous example, very well known, that just a few years earlier, before Pompey came back to Rome, Licinius Lucullus, who had indeed been busy himself fighting Mithridates in Pontus, had introduced to Italy, had brought back from his campaigns there, the cherry tree. And now there is some discussion whether it is the sour cherry or the sweet cherry, probably was the sour cherry. That's not really important for our purpose tonight. The important thing is that he campaigned there, he came back to Italy bringing a plant that was not known, a novelty, And he also gave to the plant its Latin name, Cerasus, from the town of Cerasus in Ponto, where perhaps this cherry tree were present or common. And when Pliny tells us this story, now about the naming, is it Athenaeus, is it other authors, but when Pliny talks about the introduction of the cherry trees, he gives a very matter-of-fact statement. He says, oh yes, and Lucullus brought the cherry tree to Italy, and then later on, after the conquest of Britain in 43, the cherry tree was introduced to Britain. But by doing this, by presenting the reader with what appears as a sort of very simple, you know, relation of facts, Pliny is very subtly using the plant first as a symbol of booty, basically. He's making the cherry tree part of the booty of the general. He brings with him that as well. And then, the moment he's talking about a new military conquest, the conquest of Britain, the establishment of a new province, he uses this plant this time as a symbol of the fact that Rome can come in and alter nature there, can introduce a new plant. Now Rome becomes the civilizator, you know, element. They can alter and cultivate and bring something. So it's quite a smart way of using the symbol of a specific plant, in this case the cherry, to indicate this particular expansion, this particular ideological dimension. Now, we do not know exactly whether Lucullus displayed this cherry tree in his triumph, probably not, because Pliny tells us the first person to display trees was Pompey. But of course, we need to remember that Lucullus had to wait a few years before the Senate finally decided to grant him a triumph. It was not so straightforward. And since he had come back and was a general cum imperio, so he had the military command and could not enter the sacred boundary room, the pomerium, until he held the military command, he waited a few years just outside the pomerium of Rome and doing what? Well, he busied himself creating a huge garden, the Horti Luculliani, lavish gardens that were later on reproached, for instance, by Plutarch, when he talks about Lucullus, because of the vast amount of money that was spent in creating them. There was really quite lavish gardens. So there is something going on, really, in the late Republican Rome, in involving great politicians and generals, and the way they're starting to construct their public persona, connecting it to specific plants, to specific green spaces and gardens. We know of other figures in the sources, other people that then would have introduced plants into Italy or different provinces. And we move to the imperial period now. So for instance, right before AD 14, we are told that Sextus Papinius Alienus brought into Italy from Africa the jujube tree, that's the jujolo in Italian, and the azerol from Syria, l'azeruolo. We are told that Lucius Vitellius, that's the father of the short-lived emperor Vitellius, brought two or three kinds of figs from Syria to his villa estate, to his Alban estate, and also the pistachio plant. And his colleague, this time the equus, Flaccus Pompeius, also introduced from Syria the pistachios, but this time he brought it to Spain. Now, these are slightly different cases, I think, and I'm going to come back to this when I'm going to be discussing more the consideration about the economy and the novelty of plants, because these, as far as we can say, are not plants that had a huge commercial value. It's not like the balsam tree, nor plants that are specifically associated with a region so that they can signify a conquest or a military victory. We are in a slightly different sphere. And just for the benefit of the audience who might not be familiar with jujube and azerol, how they look like. So this is the jujole, and here we have two types of azerol, the red and the white. So that's how they look like. That's small fruit, edible, fine, good. Let me stay with Pompey the Great a bit further before we leave him. After the triumph that I described, Pompey embarked in a grand building project in Rome. It's the famous theater, the first permanent theater in Rome, with, of course, topping, you know, on the cave at the temple to Venus, the divinity that was his protectress, in particular giving him favor. And behind the Scenefron's building, the porticos of Pompey. Now, A lot has been written about this complex and the portico pomp, and particularly how all the works of art displayed in them, statues, paintings, related to the celebration of Pompey's and his military deeds. What I want to focus on is the plans that probably were in there. We had the plane trees, and that's we are told about plane trees from the literary sources. Now, the plane trees is, of course, it's a very convenient tree to have in a park, in a public garden, even in his own villa, because of the, especially in summer, offers a very pleasant shade because of the foliage. But again, it loses the leaves in winter, so it doesn't block eventually sunlight. But it's also a tree that is strongly associated in the Roman writings and consideration with the idea of philosophy and a particular type of cultured philosophy, because it's the symbol, it was the tree that was at the Academy of Plato in Athens. Also in Aristotelian school, the Lyceum, there were plane trees. So it becomes, in Latin literature, a symbol of discussing the knowledge and the culture that a particular person had. So it becomes symbolic, but it was also symbolic of Asia Minor in general, because the plane tree would have come from Asia Minor and then first in Magna Graecia and then eventually to Rome. So we know that there were plane trees. Then Catherine Gleason, the archaeologist and famous scholar for studying ancient gardens, has suggested that there were probably also laurel shrubs. Well, of course, laurel is the symbol of victory, and it's a laurel wreath that the triumphator will be wearing when celebrating the triumph in Rome. And also myrtle shrubs. Now, myrtle is a plant of Venus, the goddess Venus, of course, the goddess that was the protectress of Pompey. But it's also the plant that was used in the so-called minor triumph, the ovatio, when a general didn't do such a great deeds to deserve the triumph, but well enough, you can get an ovatio. So that was the plant that would have been, the wreath would have been worn by the general. So we may have, in this particular garden, the use of plants in order to celebrate Pompey's deeds, military victories, in order to allude first to his culture, but to the fact that he had been active in Asia with the plane tree, and then by laurel and myrtle, if Gleason is correct in her suggestion, then also this allusion to his victory. And it is very likely that a complex such as this, the Portico Pompeii, had an influence then in the private sphere when we start seeing more and more with the beginning of the first century appearing, in this case, Villa San Marco, in Stabia, the portico with a large natatio, and where they found the root cavities, because this was destroyed by the eruption of Vesuvius, of plane trees. So there was a series of plane trees planted in front of the porticos. And just to give an idea of a house, that's a reconstruction of the House of the Vetti that was done years ago in Florence, at the Giardino di Bobbio, on occasion of an exhibit of ancient gardens. So it is probable that Pompey's portico might have influenced domestic architecture in the sense of this idea of how to intermingle the symbolic use of art and statuary with the use of plants, and had brought forward something that already started, that was already present in terms of that symbolism of the when it comes to garden in the domestic sphere. Now, do we have any archaeological evidence for symbolic use of plants in gardens? Perhaps we do. Let's stick with the Bay of Naples. Let's stay with Stabia, right here. But with another villa, not Villa San Marco, Villa Arianna. This was a very large complex, and it had really a huge peristyle garden, which is the one there framed in red. Now, this peristyle garden has been excavated a few years ago. What was really known before the excavation was just part of the perimeter, but nothing about the actual interior of the garden. And because this was buried by the eruption of Vesuvius of 79, it was possible to find evidence of the garden, to find root cavities, and these are giving a clue about the type of plants that were there. So what the excavation revealed is a series of raised planting beds, which are this one here, so two fully excavated, part of one and partially here. The excavation didn't continue in this part, but it assumed that it was symmetrical. And these raised planted beds showed from the distribution of the root cavities and the dimensions, so indicating different type of plants. I mean, it's not always possible to identify exactly which plant, but one can give a sense of the size of the plants, that it was planted very informally. I mean, these particular planting beds were really very informally planted and pretty much similar to what the wall paintings show, Roman garden wall paintings. So not so much a very kind of formal that in the past has been often assumed that Roman garden was always very formal type of planting, perhaps assumed because Pliny the Younger in a famous letters where he described his villa in modern Umbria, the villa in Tuscis, talks about part of the garden that had topiary art and hedges and shrubs shaped in various manners, including, and yes, Pliny was a little bit of a chapfool himself, making his own name, so shrubs shaped in the letters of his own name. So nothing like this in this case, but then also some very long and narrow planting beds, defining the beaten earth paths where one could stroll in the garden. Now these narrow planting beds are what interests me now. They presented a series of cavities relating to trees and shrubs, all different. That's what the excavators reported. They are in one file, presented just the plant in one file, about 1 meter and a half distance between each other. And they were all different plants, so that it has been suggested by the director of the project, Professor Thomas Howe, that perhaps this could have been a sort of a selection of different plants to show either it's part of the taste of the owner, or could have been perhaps something to show a little bit, you know, the extent of room connections, or you know, what one could command in terms of bringing different plants. We don't know exactly, because not all it was possible to really identify the species, except for what was at the end of each of these planting beds. And actually, I should show you how the excavation has appeared when they start uncovering the remains with the various root cavities, as part of excavation. So what was evidence for some of the ornamental raised beds, there was evidence for the use of something like this as reconstructed here for very light fencing around. So at the end of these narrow raised planting beds, from the root cavity, it seems that there were palm trees. Now the palm tree is exotic, but grows very well in southern Italy, still grows nowadays, although it can't really fruit because the average temperature in winter are not warm enough to allow really the palm to bring the dates to complete fruition. And the fact that there were palms reminded me immediately of a lost fresco. We have the watercolor, this has been destroyed, but we have a watercolor that was made at the time from the house of the Amazon, because in this fresco we have the depiction of a garden, and you see the marble balustrade, you see various shrubs, and then there are palm trees in the middle, and then there is a little shrine with some Egyptian divinity. There is Osiris and Harpocrates, little Harpocrates there, and in the background a landscape view, what appear to be maritime villas. This scene has been interpreted because of the presence of Egyptian divinity as and the palms as possibly depicting a landscape from Canopus, so a branch of the Nile just outside Alexandria, an area famous for the palaces and luxury villas since Hellenistic time. But it could perfectly be actually a view of a garden in the Bay of Naples with our painted villas in the background and, you know, palm trees growing as the palm trees identified in the garden of Villa Arianna. The palm is highly symbolic. I mean, the palm in ancient iconography is a symbol of victory, the palm branch. The palm is also associated with two specific regions. It's Egypt, it's Judea again. When, for instance, you know, we see the celebration of the victory of Cleopatra after Actium in this particular coin issue from one of the colonies established by Augustus in this is Nemausus in Gaul. We see Egypt represented as a chain crocodile. Here's the chain, chain to a palm tree. It's a plant that had a strong association, not just with Victory, but also with Augustus himself. The Suetonius tells us a story that a plant would have sprung naturally itself in the between the paving stones in front of the house of Augustus, and then you know he took great care of taking it, planting inside in the inner court next to the house of gods. It's important, and also the fact they took great pains to make it grow, to make sure that this palm will not die. I mean, this is such a great omen. What can you wish more for? A palm, symbol of Victory, just in front of your house. And as another example of Judea, this is a very famous coin series of Vespasian, again, after the end of the first Jewish revolt, to show that a specific region, so Judea, here, the personification, but the palm trees that signify the region and legend, Judea Capitol. I think that perhaps we might have an example of the fact that palm tree became a little bit fashionable in the Julio-Claudian period, from various parts of the empire. I'm going to give you one example, which is from Asia Minor, Aphrodisias. Because recent works at Aphrodisias in the area of the so-called South Agora, so it's that right there next to the theater, and this is an aerial view, a complex thought to have initially to be maybe a gymnasium or perhaps a market plaza, not an agora, but then actually turned out to have been a large complex offering porticos for relaxation, a huge pool in the middle with fountains, and from excavations they found the archaeobotanical remains and the planting beds, palms, a series of palm trees. So here we have a grove of palms that is attested in later inscriptions in Aphrodisias in a complex that in its first phase, which include the fountains, the porticos, and the palm trees, dates to the Tiberian period. It could be that the benefactor who built this for his own town was aware of the importance of the palm and of the meaning that it had for the Julio-Claudians because of that omen with Augustus. It certainly is the case that this is a period where, after a very serious earthquake in Asia Minor, many cities were seriously damaged. Tiberius himself intervened in giving relief, whether it's fiscal breaks or giving donation to help in reconstruction. So there is a connection there with the emperor giving attention to some of the cities of Asia Minor. So I just want to suggest the possibility that people, some of the notables around the empire were aware, because we do see here in Smyrna, in other places, suddenly grove of palms being established in the Julio-Claudian period, which could have something related, not simply as the palm because it's a symbol of Victory, but perhaps because the palm was important to Augustus himself and his successor. All right. Let's move on to the economic dimension. The considerations given to the productivity of plants, the importance of having fruit-bearing plants in a space, whether it is a garden or in a villa estate, is a key motive that we can see, we can follow throughout the period from the Republic to the Empire. And we can see it particularly when some authors start discussing the case of unproductive plants as something that is negative. To go back to our plane trees that we said could be the symbol of philosophy, of Plato Academy, and so forth, well, not everybody agreed, though, that the plane tree was a good thing. There are a few authors, Pliny is one of them, who actually complain and say, well, the only reason why this plant was introduced into Italy is not because it bore fruit. So for him, a fruit-bearing plant is a good reason to be, transplanted and introduced, but just because of its shade, its sterile shade. Horace talks about the fact that now in gardens and in villa estates, the elm that was a tree that was used to train vines of it. So rather than using a post to create a pergola, you could use a live tree to train the grapevines, and the elm is a good tree to do that in a farm because it gives good fodder for your cattle. But he complains, Horace, well, now we don't have the elm anymore. We don't have the marriage of the elm and the vine anymore. What we see is the unproductive plane tree. And the anecdote about Hortensius, Quint Hortensius, and the plane trees in his peristyle garden encapsulate completely this idea of negating productivity. Only the very rich can do this. They can completely negate the aspect of the productive farm, because he had plane trees, and we're told he was watering them with wine. I don't think that was true, but what this anecdote proves is the idea that not only he does not have the elm with the vine trailing on it, producing in his estate, he has plants that are even consuming his wine stock. So they're not producing plant, but even consuming what a villa estate should have. So the idea of agricultural productivity, even when villas have become much more luxurious and lavish, is still there on the ideological level, is always there present and becomes important. And I think this explains why, as one could display a particular exotic plant in a garden or a particular work of art, also prominent Romans start displaying their botanical knowledge, their horticultural knowledge. In the Augustan period in particular, there is a flourishing of treatises written by prominent figures on, you know, horticulture, treatise on viticulture, treatise on grafting. And we are told of many prominent people that would have engaged personally in grafting new fruit. It's mostly apples, but not only, also figs. Pompey the Great is one of them. Then the good friend of Augustus, Gaius Matius, who by the way was also the person credited for having invented the topiary art. We have Turanius Niger, we have Livia herself, the wife of Augustus. Also, she would have herself grafted a new type of fig. And then we have a lot of names, not the specific individuals, but all names that comes from the fruit, have been named after them, listing famous gentes of Rome, some famous families. Just put some on the slides, but the list in Pliny goes on for quite a long time. And it seems that this display of skillful horticulture, it really starts becoming something attached to somebody's social standing. The higher the social standing, the more the person would be expected to have this. Pliny goes on in saying that he had heard with his own ears, now of course he's not saying I've seen it, I've heard with my own ears, a man of consular rank boasting that he had a walnut tree that would bear fruit twice a year. Now that's not possible. But here we have a consular rank, he must have something that is more than the rest. So it all becomes again this, you know, competitive display. So what this interest in fruit grafting shows, I believe, is the fact that agricultural production was important, and one could engage in consideration of this production because it was according to the traditional values of Roman aristocracy, where agriculture always been the what, you know, a good Roman should do, regardless of what they did in practice. But on the logical level, the good Romans of old times, they were farmers, they were soldiers, that was a good time of the Republic when the mores had not been corrupted yet. And this is also show, though, an interest in, of course, in one's resources. One has many agricultural properties. What to do, what to grow, is an important choice to make. And this brings me to the last bit, where I want to think a little bit more specifically about two examples that show, I believe, this interest on the part of elite in investing and in trying to ameliorate production because of the importance of productivity on estate. So I'm starting first with the peach and very recent discoveries. I'm very grateful to Dr. Rea for discussing these discoveries with me. During the works of Metro C, I have a huge farm, agricultural estate has been discovered with a very large reservoir and works for irrigation, and with evidence for peach cultivation in particular. So it seems that this estate was devoted mainly to the cultivation of peaches, and some of the archaeobotanical remains, many seeds, pits of the peach, and also, I'm sorry about the quality of this one, with what you see here, this darker shadow, are actually the roots of the peach trees that then at a certain point, later phase, you know, the trees were cut. This is an estate where it seems that a novel plant, because the date of this, it's, you know, late 1st century BC, early 1st century AD, and that's the time where we know that the peach was introduced into Italy. So here we have a new plant, or at least a specific type, variety of peach, is what Pliny said, had been introduced only 30 years before its time, being cultivated on a larger scale, and somebody investing considerable amount of money in the infrastructure, including a water lifting device connected to the irrigation. The socket of the water lifting device are here, the wheel, the water wheels, and the marks left, and other irrigation, elements of irrigation, the irrigation infrastructure, all belonging to one person because they found the stems, the initial of the letters. So all becoming to somebody that had invested a considerable amount of money in cultivating a new fruit to target the market of Rome. I mean, of course, it's just outside Rome city walls. Fresh fruit for the large market of Rome, where the demand was certainly high. The chestnut is a different story, and I brought this example because I think it shows how there is an interest in trying to improve even things that might not have a great appreciation at the moment. Now, the fruit, the nut, wasn't really appreciated in Roman time at all. I mean, it was considered food for the poor, for the shepherds. And, you know, Pliny called it a vilissima. You know, why did nature bother so much to protect, you know, the chestnuts when it's such a, you know, it's the least valuable of things? But it does say that there were, you know, some chestnuts, particularly the one from Campania, two variety he singles out, again named after the people who had grafted them. The Corellian and the Terrean, two variety grafted that were, you know, the best of all. So if you really want to eat chestnut, these are the best of all. And the we know from recent discoveries connected to the excavation of the ancient port of Naples or Neapolis, there have been archaeobotanical finds, taxa recovered, showing indeed the presence of chestnuts there and the consumption of chestnuts for food from the first century AD onwards. So what I think is happening here, although the chestnut per se is not a valuable fruit, it's not comparable to a peach that is exotic and can command high price on the market. There were some peach, according to Pliny, were selling for 30 denarii a piece. It's not that, but perhaps somebody is trying to experiment by using their practice, you know, their knowledge and grafting in seeing, can we develop any quality in this fruit that will make it better, that will make it something that is then more sought after, more appreciated. Probably time to draw some conclusions. So, the examples that I've presented tonight, I think show that we have plants and gardens, and particularly when we think about fruit trees, moving on two very different levels. On the one level, we have the symbolic, the ideological one. Plants could become a symbol of a specific region, could be used to signify a conquest, could become something that is an indicator of the territorial expansion of Rome. And indeed, as has been commented, for instance, Diana Spencer, when discussing columellas, when in book 10, devoted to horticulture, columella goes on in a list of vegetables coming from different places, geographic regions and places around Rome Empire. This becomes a synecdoche of Rome Empire. And this particular use of the plants, I think, can be contextualized very well within that interest in, general interest in geographic knowledge that we had at the time, in expeditions that would map new regions, that would produce maps, let's think of the map of Agrippa, for instance, in the ability of listing the flora and the fauna of a particular territory that had been explored for the first time. It also showed, though, how we have an interest in ameliorating existing fruit variety for commercial reasons, or introducing new fruit that one didn't know before. So when, you know, Vitellius brings the fig trees from Syria, and new types of fig trees to Syria, to his Alban estate, there is not a matter of symbolic conquest of a region. It's a matter, perhaps, of a commercial consideration, or perhaps simply of a sort of personal souvenir. I've encountered these plants while being a governor there. I enjoy them, and I would like to have it on my farm. The experimental grafting to grow new trees is, I think, something that engaged a lot of different people in Rome, even prominent Romans that are concerned about the production of their estate. And I want to conclude with this particular fable from Phaedrus, because I think it encapsulates very nicely the play between fructus, that is the fruit of a plant, but fructus in Latin is also profit and gain. And in this fable, we are told that there were all the various divinity, the gods, that they are choosing their plant, the plant that's going to be, you know, associated with them. Of course, you have Zeus and the oak and the Venus and the myrtle and the Phoebus and the laurel and so forth. And then Minerva wonders at a certain point, say, hold on a moment, why are you choosing unproductive plants? Why is this? You know, Zeus said, well, it's just not to show, to give the impression to be selling the honor for the price of the fruit. And she replies, well, and I'm going to read you the original Latin where you have the translation there. At me Hercules, narrabit, quod quis voluerit, oliva nobis proper fructum est gratior. So I'm choosing the olive because of its fruit. But here fruit, as a double play, is the actual fruit of the plant, but is the profit that the olive oil can give. So what best to encapsulate the idea of the importance of productivity and the symbol of plants. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Annalisa, for bringing so brilliantly together this highly literary genre of knowledge of plants, presentation of plants, the economic considerations, the most up-to-date archaeological discoveries, a real tour de force. We've got a bit of a gardener's world here at British School at Rome at the moment, so there are plenty of people who are going to chip in. But let me start. I've often wondered whether we are allowed to be metaphorical about grafting. I mean, there is a sense in which it ought to be something that one might get slightly perturbed about. You take something that's perfect and then you kind of turn it into something that's hybrid, metamorphosis and so on and so forth. And in the context of a Roman populace, or Roman people who sometimes regard themselves as very, you know, pure, but the other side are very open to change. Are we allowed to do this? Are we allowed to think that when Pliny praises the idea of being grafting things together to produce something that's better, we can make that a synecdoche of the fact that Rome itself is able to spread and graft new parts onto itself, particularly in the context of all this importation of not only goods, but also peoples into the empire. Are we allowed to do that, or is that just a modern literary critic taking things too far?
No, I think we are allowed to do that. I mean, certainly the grafting, and it's not just Pliny, of course, it's Virgil as well, has a symbolic, a metaphorical meaning of the ability to manipulate nature. So there is that, of course, is obvious, and the ingenuity of the person that can, because then we have all these stories about very weird grafting. I mean, things that are botanically impossible, but we are told in the sources that they would have grafted completely different species of plant on the same one, and you have this kind of really almost monstrous production that are pushing the possibility of what nature is possible. And of course, Pliny's work is not simply an encyclopedia. It's within the context of the Flavian period, it's this particular knowledge has to do a lot with how the empires are presented, it's a lot with imperialism and the idea of Rome. So yes, I think we can push it and think of how Rome will always be able to take the best and allowing those who are the best, as you do in selecting the plant, select the best, what is the best fruit variety, you're going to graft only this one onto that and try to make it even better. Yeah, thank you.
Hello. Thank you so much. That was a really fantastic talk. Can you talk a little bit more about Pompey the Great and the portico? What sort of evidence is there for the possible planting of the laurel and the myrtle as opposed to other plants?
The in Pompey's portico, I mean, that's Catherine Gleason's suggestion that it could be laurel and myrtle, not because there is any specific botanical evidence. Is just based on the fact that we know that in terms of the works of art display that were all related to Pompey's campaign, away or another, alluding to his military campaigns and the victory. And the sources mention the plane trees. We have that from the literary source of the plane trees. So there is a suggestion that possibilities would have been the laurel because of the meaning and the myrtle, but there is no other evidence for that.
It's a question really about the terminology, the Latin terminology of the gardening techniques. And I was wondering how precise they are about the processes of grafting, because there are various techniques, and whether, I mean, throughout you've been referring to grafting specifically. I wondered if there are consistent references to other techniques of producing new plants, such as hybridization, for example, which is a common technique nowadays.
In the agricultural writers, so when you go to Columella and then later in the Empire, Palladius, they are very precise and they describe the different types of grafting that one can do. So with the various type of incision and how they are very precise. Pliny is a bit more generic. He just talks about inserere, the grafting action. Although in a couple of occasions he does say, oh, this was a different, a new technique that was used. So certainly in the agricultural writers, they can be very precise, and they do talk also about other form of propagation of plants. I'm trying to think of the English name now, excuse me. Talea, for instance, they discuss about how to propagate a plant by talea. So you can have, the offshoot, you let put the root, and only that you cut it from the mother plant. There is certainly knowledge when it comes to the technical treatises is there. What is in the literature and authors like Pliny or in poetry, Virgil, of course you have what they're really interested in is this idea you can control nature, you can manipulate it, which is a very strong motive in a lot of Roman thought, where it is in art. In the landscape paintings, you never really have a completely wild landscape. There is even the bucolic scene, there is always the little temple, there is something that shows the presence of man. So it's something very strongly rooted, I think, this idea that nature can be ordered, organized, tamed, and controlled, and that's a symbol of Roman civilization.
Thank you very much, that was fantastic. I wanted to follow on, actually, from what Phil was asking and talk a little bit more about... So you import all these things into Rome, you bring them in your triumph or whatever. How do you keep them alive? I mean, there must be a lot of anxiety about the possible failure of this. I know people get very upset if sacred trees die. Mm-hmm. I mean, what's the infrastructure for keeping alive if you're going to have a garden that stands as a kind of gazetteer of the world? How are you going to keep alive, the alpine plants and the tropical plants and the, is there an infrastructure for that? Do they talk about that? Or is it just something you don't talk about?
They don't talk about it. They don't talk about the practicalities.
Well, that's really interesting.
transporting live plant is possible if you take the entire, the root ball, you leave the earth around it. And we saw in that Egyptian painting relief there with the basket, and actually there was an article by a botanist describing that one and saying that it shows the perfect way to transplant tree, the way they've done it, the way they tied the basket to the branch. Said this is really they had the know-how to transport tree, because that's how you do it, so that you don't damage the roots. But how you ensure that, you know, doesn't happen, that the plant dies, or that if you want trying to grow plants from regions that are not quite the same climate. I mean, when we hear about the ebony tree displayed in Triumph, it's very unlikely that was planted and it could grow in Rome. It's a plant that comes from much warmer and arid climate, so it's very unlikely that. So, you know, it was enough to display in the Triumph and then patch it. Yes, but it's very interesting. All the technical, all the nice, juicy details that we would like to have. You know, how do you actually make this happen? We don't have that. So there we can only hope that archaeology one day can give us some glimpses.
Thank you.
Amy must have seen some of my efforts at gardening. yes, please.
Is this the House of Livia?
It is.
Is this representative of a true garden? Have we been able to identify the plants in this? Oh, sorry. Have we been able to identify the plants in this fresco of this room? And can we say anything about how realistic that scene would be in a real garden?
Would it? Yeah, the plants have been identified. There is a variety of plants. There are, you know, apples and pomegranates, and there are palm trees, and there are pines. There is laurel. I mean, they're all been identified. Indeed the palm was right there. There is an element of that is not realistic in the sense that, as in other Roman wall paintings representing gardens, you often have plants that may bear fruit at different season, depicted having fruit all together, or the same plant having flowers and fruit. So that's an element that is unrealistic. But as far as the arrangement, the excavations from Villa Arianna seem really to suggest that this kind of, you know, really informal, dense planting, it was reflecting really the reality of many of the gardens, ancient houses.
Thank you very much. I just wanted to ask just regarding what you say at the end there about the gods that choosing fruits that are unproductive, or trees that don't have fruit apart from Minerva and the olive, thinking that, applying that to, or Pompey's portico, and I wonder whether there's any significance there in the fact then that he chooses, and that there are trees there that are completely bear no fruit at all, replacing in an area where, and then previously then we have, and then the Villa Publica with then very, you know, more productive plants, so turning, how does this reflect on the transformation of the urban space by Pompey, then from, say, productive Villa Publica into these, you know, fruitless trees of the portico. Yeah.
Well, certainly from a purely practical point of view, somebody's planting a garden, so now leaving aside ideology or symbolism, evergreens, you know, if you have the plate trees because of the shade they give in the summer, and then evergreens such as possibly laurel and myrtle, if indeed these plants were there, we don't know, it makes sense. You know, you will have a nice space, you don't have to worry if that fruit, the fruit start falling down on your path, people strolling and things like that. But indeed, that's the reason why some people were not that happy with those choices. That's the reason why some of the moralist writers then later on start looking at, you know, what was going on in the late Republic as really the symbol of how much morals have been corrupted, because all these luxuries and unproductiveness is really going at the heart of what should have been the real values of Rome. So for some, including, you know, our Pliny the Elder, that provided so much material tonight for this question, the plane trees or things that are not productive are not good because they're not utilis. That's the same adjective that Phaedrus uses in that fable when Zeus replied. You know, if you do something utilis, then the glory you can derive for it is good, otherwise it's foolish. And Pliny said in the passage again, nothing can be that small, not to give glory, as far as long as it is utilis, useful. But it's important, I think, your point. Yes, I think that's the choice there is symbolic because these are plants of victory, or the plane trees is associated with the world of culture and philosophy and the East in general. So it symbolized where, you know, Pompey carried out his military campaigns, but for some in Rome, some of the moralists, the fact that these were unproductive is a negative element, is a negative that, you know, to criticize.
Thank you very much indeed. I have a short question about the nice episode of Hortensius of watering his trees with wine. Now, I'm not much of a gardener. I'm not quite sure how good is that for trees. And which brings me to the question, do we have any evidence for kind of the elite garden consumption culture of deliberately putting something on display only for a short period? I mean, the difference between a garden and, let's say, every day a huge bunch of flowers, which are only good for a couple of days, is quite evident. So in terms of conspicuous consumption, a garden is something like, well, it lasts longer. So if you have lots of money, you could also have a garden and plant deliberately things which only last for one season or only for a short period. Do we have any more evidence going in this direction?
In terms of the wine, as I said, I don't think that's a real anecdote. I mean, that it was watering, but I think it symbolizes, you know, something there about, you know, negating productivity, because those trees are drinking up his wine, you know, stock, what he has in his wine cellar. It's been suggested that the gardens in elite villas, in very rich houses, would have changed. Especially as far as, you know, flowers are concerned, often because of all the planting pots that we, you know, they found in excavation, the olle perforate, that does also allow to more easily remove a plant and, you know, put a new one. A little bit what happens, you know, nowadays in public parks, etc., with change of the season, gardener come in and you prepare all the new flower beds. So that's, you know, it's been suggested that there was certainly, and we certainly know of wealthy household having slave gardeners as part of their, the household slaves. All the inscriptions relating to gardeners, slaves skilled in the topiary art come from here around Rome, is either the suburbium, there are a few from the Bay of Naples where there were villas, of course, there are a couple from Como where there also, you know, villas, but it's all related to really the place where the big villas were. Flowers were certainly used in a lot of rituals and in banquets, from using petals and of roses and violets in the wine to garlands, etc. And that, I'm sure that the more you could display the freshest, the nicest, the better, you know, you could, there was and was showing your social standing. But there, besides whatever might be indicated in the literary text, that we don't have any other, you know, evidence for that sort of conspicuous consumption when it comes to the ephemeral aspect of flowers.
Any gamblers were supposed to suffocate people with rose petals, wasn't it? For dinner parties. Yes, please.
Thank you very much. I appreciated how you kind of separated the symbolic function of plants and the economic one. It was sort of from an analytical point of view very clear. But with almost every example, like the one with the wine, for example, I was also struck that I could see both functions in the same example, right? So you attack the plants because the Jews attack the plants, for example, because they are an economic basis, but also symbolize an empire, of course, and you can apply this to almost every example. So I'm kind of wondering, when we think of plants today, like one thing is purely aesthetic appreciation. And that's something that I've just tried to go through your examples from your talk. I couldn't find that anywhere, that plants were just appreciated because they're beautiful. It's always the skill of grafting or an economic function or representing something like that. Is there any purely aesthetic discourse about gardens, plants, anything like
that? Maybe the case of the lotus tree, the one of the anecdote about the house of Crassus, because what we are told about that tree in the sources, it says, well, it has a very pleasant bark, a very pleasant to look at because of the type of color, and also it gives a very nice shade in summer, but then early in the autumn we shed the leaves, so you're not going to get your rooms, you know, losing sunlight or when the days are becoming shorter. So maybe there is purely
although there's aesthetic. A little bit of a function then too, that it provides shade, right?
Yes, there's the function of the shade. But just that detail about, you know, the bark that is pleasant to look at, maybe that's okay. But you're absolutely right. I mean, for a simply, you know, matter of organization, I broke the two themes that I wanted to touch on tonight, but they are strictly intermingled together.
Thank you.
Of the vine, and you're very welcome to join us for a drink upstairs, but not before thanking Annalisa for this splendid talk. Thank you so much.